for tuning in and being patient with us.
You need to turn it down now.
Yeah, because it's going to be
radio.
Yeah.
All right.
Look,
I got my people coming on from Chicago.
I see. Yes.
Hey,
yes.
Michigan. Okay, look now. We got...
It's good.
We got two people in here from Chicago. Diamond is from Chicago. Diamond, why don't you tell them a little bit about yourself so they know who we have here?
Yes. Okay. Well, hey, everyone. I'm excited to be here. My name is Diamond Nurse, and I am originally from Chicago. I always have to represent. I am a mom of beautiful Emerald Nurse, and I've been married for 5 years. My husband and I moved here from Chicago. He's from Brooklyn, and we just love what we do. We are in the business of people. I have a social media management company. I'm also a contributor on WCCB News, and I'm just living my best life. I love to travel. I love to share my story, share my experiences, anything that I can do to help people. That's what I love. And so I'm excited to be here with everyone today.
Well, let me just say this. I told Damien, I guess a couple weeks ago, we were chatting. I said, look, you know, I talked to Diamond and I got somebody to do a postpartum show. Now, Diamond and I, we met because somebody from Chicago that we know, Muhammad, if he watches the show, yes. Muhammad sent me a message basically saying, do you know Diamond? And I said, no. So he linked us on social media. He said he would, and he did. He thought it was very strange that we didn't know each other. And I think so too, seeing how everybody we know in common, yes. But that's how Chicago is. So basically we made acquaintances, and then you invited me to a family picnic. Yep. And that's how we met. And so that was great. Diamond, her husband, and some of their friends, I brought Quran, and it kind of established a relationship. But I saw Diamond a couple weeks ago at a baby shower, and I just thought, you know, at that baby shower that we need to be tackling postpartum depression. And I asked her, and she very eagerly agreed to do this. So we're happy that she's here to talk about this openly. We just want to make it more of a habit to talk about all of these mental health issues that we cover on the show, because they are all significant, and they're all meaningful to somebody. So you need to share this video as much as possible so that it has the potential to reach the individuals who need to see it. Are you going to smile like that the whole time?
I'm just so excited.
Okay, Diamond. Okay.
I'm looking at all of the messages coming in. I'm like, hey, Ashley,
now,
I love you.
I didn't have the best day, but I'm looking at your smile. I'm like, why are we smiling? So, but that's great. I mean, it's contagious. So I'm not usually just smiling the whole time, but I'm looking at you like, why are we smiling? Okay, postpartum. So, Damien, sorry. It's a girl's moment, but
yes,
yes. All right. I'm going to let y'all get the girl's moment out.
We're done with that.
We're
done with that, and we're ready to move on. How's the week going?
Actually better. I was actually a little bit under the weather Monday and Tuesday, just sinuses and, well, just feeling kind of blah, but feeling much better today. So I don't know if she told you, we normally do like a weekly check-in with our couch family as well as any guests that we have on. So we kind of do a weekly check-in. We normally rate where we're at, 1 to 10, 10 being like a really, really good day and 1 being a really sucky day. So I would probably say I'm probably at about an 8. Probably, 8.5 actually. Oh.
Okay. I'm gonna let you give yours, and then yours is gonna be a higher number. I'll give mine first. Thank you. I could judge by the look on your face. So Diamond's number is higher than mine, so I'm going first. Normally I would let the guests go first, but I spent the first 4 hours of the day in bed. I was not feeling well. I had some outpatient stuff going on yesterday, and I still feel the effects, so I'm not that well, but I am happy to be here. I'm always glad to come here and talk about things that people need to hear about and to share this mental health wealth and education. So I feel more like a 6. I think I give 2 numbers just being here. Otherwise, I'd be a 4, because I am not feeling well right now. But we're gonna make it through.
I'm gonna give you all these positive, all these positive vibes. Yeah. Well, today I would say I started off at an 8.5, and now that I'm here, I'm definitely a 10. I'm so excited to just share my story and just talk about this topic because it's something that is so cliche, especially in the African American culture, or we don't talk about it. Mm-hmm. We're not honest. So I'm just super excited to just be authentic and share and just be vulnerable with you guys today. So I'm feeling good. I will say that we've been traveling the past 12 days.
Okay.
When I say we, Emerald and I, mm-hmm. we were in Chicago, and so we're trying to get back on our schedule.
Okay.
She has woken up every 3 hours for the past 3 nights.
So you're tired.
So I'm tired.
You look good though.
Yes. Thank you. Okay. And I just tell myself, I get to do this. I get to wake up with her. I get to do this. I get mm-hmm. to be a mom. So
oh, you that start helps with me. Gratitude.
Oh, gratitude.
Oh, it's necessary. Look, y'all are fighting at 7 a.m. in your house. You need to start with gratitude.
That's right.
I'm just saying, no, nobody wants to fight. I'm sorry. I'm airing stuff out now. Look, some of y'all on here are fighting before 9. Don't do that before you go to work.
Yeah, you know, some this happens in hostile homes where communication is not that effective. So we just want to make sure that you start, you know, with some gratitude every morning, and that might be the key to a better day.
Right.
So.
Yeah, and finding out what you're grateful for. If you can list 5 things mm-hmm. starting out the day, that's usually a good start.
I try.
5
is good.
Yeah, 5 is a good, nice number.
Karan's always number 1, no matter what he's bothering me about. So anyway. You want to do the hot topic now?
Yeah, so we're going to definitely dive into our weekly mental health hot topic, as I express every week. Damn it, Jackie over here is kind of like the Wendy Williams of mental health.
I like that.
So
at least on our show, I am.
She goes off on her, you know, her rants and any, I call them rants.
You do call them rants.
But they're very informative, I must say.
Connotation.
They're very informative, so they're informative rants, you guys. Did that clean it up a little bit?
Yeah, I'm good with that.
Okay.
Thanks.
So you had a particular topic. Mm-hmm. I forget what it was. So let's dive into it.
Okay.
Yes.
So I just noticed, I don't know if you saw it, Diamond, but something happened on The View, and they were discussing Gwyneth Paltrow and her husband living in separate homes. And, you know, they were asking the opinions of everyone on the stage, and I just remember distinctively Whoopi Goldberg, Xander, saying that she was totally for it, and whatever works for that marriage, mm-hmm. who is she really to put her opinion on somebody's marriage and what works for them?
Right.
I know that I was making a face in my house alone. It was judgment. And I was like, what? And then I started thinking a little more. And when they got into the dynamics of what the home situation is for each of them, they have teenagers. So he's got teenagers or a teenager, and she has the same now. And they're saying, look, teenagers are sensitive. They can create stressful issues where there is no stress. That's enough. Mm-hmm. So we love each other. We want to be married. And for now, for us, that means we live separately, but we see each other every day or as often as possible. And they're okay with it. So I started to think, well, Jesus, if they're okay with it, don't I have enough to be concerned about in my own life?
Listen.
Well, I'm just being honest. So at first, I, you know, kind of got my nose up in the air about it. And then less than 2 minutes later, I said, well, I'm in my own damn business. I'm not married, so.
Well, I mean, I think that kind of goes back to when we were talking about alternative relationships mm-hmm. on a previous episode. And, you know, what works for you may not work for the next person. And, you know, I'm always the person that's thinking outside the box. I'm not normal, so I'm not going to date someone that's normal. So whatever works for us, works for us. You know, I'm definitely not traditional by any means mm-hmm. of, you know,
yes,
in regards to relationships.
We could tell by watching the show.
Really?
Just go back and watch some back episodes. Yes, we know. Okay. So you think it's cool.
Yeah. I mean, if that's going to keep the marriage together and their relationship, you know, in a good space and it's peaceful and everybody is prospering and it's successful for them, why not?
Diamond. I recently actually read an article. It's called LAT Lifestyle, Living Apart Together.
Mm-hmm.
And
it's a
whole thing. It's a lifestyle.
Yeah. I was going to say, this isn't a thing.
So
even if
you're in like a committed relationship or even a marriage, they're like, you can live on the same block. You can live even mm-hmm. in the same building, but people want their space. And in the article I was reading, the young lady was saying that she just needed to just go and do her own thing and have her own space. But one side of me immediately, like you, like I'm judging.
Yep.
I'm like, what? Like, just don't get married. And then the other side is like, well, some people really do need that space. But then I feel that you probably can run away from different situations because it's like, okay, I'm going to my own home.
Yep.
So you run away from those tough conversations, which are needed for growth. Mm-hmm. There's beauty on the other side of those tough things. So I would say if you can create boundaries,
then so you know how we put people on the spot.
Go ahead.
I wanted to ask a question. So I like Tim. So Tim comes to you, everything's great. And then he says, hey, babe, you know, I was thinking we should try this thing out next week for one day where we live apart. We do this, what, live in LAT? We live apart together. And, you know, because we just are in sync in so many ways and everything's going great. And so I find that I'm a little stressed here or a little stressed there, and it might be better for us. I might have a better attitude, maybe. Let's just say it's one day a week.
Mm-hmm.
How are you responding?
Oh, that's a negative.
Oh, that's a hell no. That's what she wanted to
say. Exactly.
Oh, that's a hell no.
100% no.
So I think with that,
okay,
I think it definitely comes with more communication, and communication is definitely needed, trust and all those things. So you can't have any barriers or any things within your foundation, within your marriage, that could negatively impact that. Because, I mean, if you're already jealous or you're insecure, whatever the case may be, then that's going to make you even more insecure.
Right.
So, of course, it's not going to work.
Right.
But if you're open and you're honest and you're being vulnerable and it works for both of you guys, then, hey, why not? If you can financially do it and it doesn't cause a strife.
One of our audience members said, hey, if you want to live apart one day a week, you're not ready for marriage.
Exactly.
Okay.
Agreed.
Okay. All righty.
Again, that's, the opinions.
Well, at least not the traditional view of marriage, right? You have to admit that you're just into an alternative lifestyle. You know, the way I look at it is I'm not married, but this is not something I'd be okay with because I believe it only opens the door to more alterations. And I am not comfortable with many alterations that can come as a result of starting to live separately one day a week. And we all know I have too much anxiety for that shit. So I'm not doing it.
So you knowing yourself.
I'm too concerned about, not even based off track record, just things that could happen. I'm more concerned about what could happen rather than afraid or fearful of trust, of what they're going to do to defy my trust in that moment based on what they've done. I'm just more concerned about what's going to happen.
But again, that goes back to, again, your foundation, knowing who you are.
Okay. I am a hell no person. So, hell no.
And understanding that and being able to accept that.
Okay.
However, I do have a caveat with that.
A caveat?
Yes.
How do you spell caveat?
Hey, look it up.
I'm always
Google
trying to
caveat.
Okay, all right.
But
that answers my question.
But you know, you don't make me lost.
Go ahead. You know that was a good word, counselor.
But I don't know. If you're anxious, I mean, you're just anxious. But saying that any types of alterations are you having difficulty with changes is going to be a major deal breaker for you. I mean, hopefully you do change.
Not those kind of changes, Damien. Everybody's not open to that.
I mean, but,
you know. Let's not make the show about this, but we could use
this as a whole topic.
Okay, this is an introduction. We'll use this. Y'all come back a couple weeks later, and we're going to talk about alternative marital lifestyles.
We can get all into that. I can talk about that all day.
Okay.
Just like I can with mental health. So, talking about mental health, let's go ahead and get into our topic, postpartum depression.
Yes.
Definitely a huge issue, especially in the African American community. It's actually an epidemic. Did my research. You know I like to research all my stuff.
Yes, we
know. So I definitely got some numbers, some statistics, all that good stuff. So we're going to dive into that. But my first question for my college family, for you guys here, let's identify what postpartum depression is. First and foremost.
Okay. Well, I want to talk about the difference between postpartum and baby blues because I have heard mothers, I have tried to engage, and I want to go back to what you said about people are not honest, okay?
Mm-hmm.
Because these, I don't know where you non-honest women are draining. It's hard to have a conversation with you. I just can't. But basically, when I come out and say, oh yeah, I struggled with this my first year, and the comments are, I just had the baby blues for a little bit or for 2 years. No. If you had the baby blues for more than
2 weeks,
a few weeks,
maybe 4 weeks,
you had postpartum depression, boo. stop trying to downplay that. Yeah. You had a mental health disorder. I know you don't want to hear that. But at some point, we all do. At some point, we all do, though. You've got to be more open about that. So let's just stop trying to disguise that as what it's not. Right. Baby blues is, you know, all mothers have anxiety. All mothers are concerned. All mothers. We don't know what we're doing until it happens and we learn it. You have to learn a whole new way of living.
Right.
And then you feel as though you're responsible for the way another human is living. And so if you're concerned about the way you're living, you're surely concerned about the life you provide for the new human. Mm-hmm. So there's the concerns, the anxiety, depression, and then there is, you've got to now be concerned with the spouse and whether you're still satisfying to the spouse, what they're thinking, are they honest, what they notice, what they don't. And all that. Well, so
hormones. Don't forget about
the hormones. The hormones adds to that effect of having baby blues.
So what I'm saying, let's define what that is.
But I am. I'm starting with baby blues because long-term baby blues that qualifies as postpartum.
So what is baby blues?
I just described it, I believe. I know that 80% of women that have children have it. So
but
it's associated with anxiety, depression, and the constant hormonal ups and downs after having a baby.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. So. And all of that can actually be rooted from hormones.
Yeah, and we can go, listen, pull up Google and let's get the Google definition.
Google doctor.
Right.
Well.
The Google person over there. Saying. But, I mean, like.
That's the definition.
One of the major things that I saw reading, of course, and I think you kind of mentioned it, that almost nearly 80% or more, you know, experience some type of postpartum mood disorder from baby blues all the way to postpartum psychosis. I mean, we're going to touch on that as well.
I think it's reverse. I think it's 80%. I got 80% with baby blues and then 15% of them have postpartum.
No, I'm saying overall it's 80%.
Oh, okay.
And it's 20% that actually experience postpartum depression or more. Because they always kind of give you a lower
number. Our articles were written at different times, I think, but it's almost the same.
But the most, I guess, pronounced statistic that I saw was that of that 80% or what have you, or the 20%, whatever you want to say it is, African-American women experience it 44% of the time versus, I think it was 31% of Caucasians.
Okay.
So I wanted to kind of dive in to some of those variables, some of those factors that lead to that increased number as to why African Americans experience it more than Caucasians.
Do you know the answer to that?
Why do I?
You were going to.
Yes,
you,
I do.
Have questions you know the
well,
answer to.
Well, you get into the statistics and then we want to talk about our experiences. So go ahead. And,
okay.
Yeah, because we both had children.
Well, the care on for African American women is significantly different.
Right.
Everything from support on breastfeeding, support on just what to do when you get home, everything support from the family and your village, what does that look like, the stresses that come from like going back to work and just all those different things. So, I mean, starting with the hospital care and then the knowledge that they provide African-American women. I know I had some friends who delivered in more southern states than we are in North Carolina, and they saw a clear difference between their Caucasian counterpart and the support they were receiving on just expressing their milk and learning to breastfeed, and then they were given formula.
Okay. You know what I think this is, and so you have your research, but based on being a black woman, this goes back to other shows that we've done. Black people do not talk about negative emotions, okay?
Right.
We are trained up as children to keep our mouths shut.
Mm-hmm.
It is a sign of weakness in our community that has plagued our community and continues to, and we just gonna have to keep talking about it. Because y'all are not expressing yourself. You don't want to go to therapy. There's a stigma attached to it. The men, okay, I've seen households where women bring up therapy and the men are like, hey, if something's wrong with you, go ahead and talk to who you need to talk to. Feel free.
Yeah.
Right.
I mean, I'll watch the baby while you go do that, but I'm not going.
Rather than saying, okay, because we are together, it's a we thing. It's not an individual.
But that doesn't even
thing.
Feel like support.
Yeah.
So then it's like you're afraid to tell people outside your house, and then inside your house you feel ridiculed and scrutinized.
Right.
So why the hell would they tell anybody? It's kind of like it becomes that epidemic that's silent and nobody wants to discuss
it. Right.
Mm-hmm.
Mm. That's pretty deep.
All right, I'm sorry, but it aggravates me. I just support can look many different ways, but it's not telling someone do that on your own, and mm-hmm. you're in a household with a woman who's likely to suffer from postpartum depression sometime soon.
Right. And,
no, I was going to say the support looks different. And then also what I've noticed personally is that the men, like my husband's friends, are more honest with him about what's really going on. Mm-hmm. And I'll talk to their wives who says like, oh, my baby's doing XYZ. And then he and I will come and talk, and he's like, oh, the baby hasn't slept, the baby hasn't done this. And I'm like,
the mama's drained, she ain't doing the work, right. She's passing out on the porch. And you're like,
Image was just talking about how wonderful she's doing. Wow. So that's why even when I posted something on my stories, I'm like, you gotta have your tribe. Yeah. Like you gotta have those moms who will be authentic and honest with you, mm-hmm. and he's going through it with you. And I honestly had to step away from some friendships who was not being honest. And even if that was their experience, even though I'm like, I'm no doctor, I haven't studied and researched, but I feel that 100% of women go through something at some point, and it looks different for each of us.
It's too major of a life shift.
So tell us a little bit about your story as far as your experiences with postpartum depression, and how did it look for you? Because, like you said, for everyone it's different. We're going to go down the list of, you know, the physical symptoms, emotional behavior, and all those mm-hmm. things. But how did it look for you?
Mm-hmm. So I can even say that I even was kind of that at first in denial, because mm-hmm. I would notice that my friends would text me like, hey, Diamond, I want to come to the house. And I would make a date. Mm-hmm. Like, yeah, come on over. And then that date would come. I would say, oh, the baby's sleeping. Oh, I'm really tired. You can't come. So mm-hmm. I noticed like I would like cancel plans a lot. Right. Or I would just wake up in the middle of the night just crying. And so luckily, like one of my best friends, Dr. Carla Higginbotham, would text her at any time of night. Or even some of my friends on Instagram who I don't even see. And they were like, girl, you got this. And just kind of really supported me, because I would just cry because mm-hmm. I felt so overwhelmed with joy. And just like that, I didn't even know what to do. I didn't want to make a mistake. Or I'm like, can I be a mom? Mm-hmm. Questioning everything. Questioning can I be a businesswoman? Can I be a wife? Like, can I be all these things that I already was? So I'm just like questioning everything mm-hmm. now that I have this bundle of joy. And like you said, this human to mm-hmm. try to... I don't even know what the first steps are. And luckily, and I was blessed that my mom stayed with me for 8 weeks and just really, supporting us.
Absolutely.
And
she was Shout out to the moms
who will
take 8 weeks out of their lives to come stay with their babies and their babies. Go ahead.
She stayed with us, and she encouraged us to go on dates. She encouraged us to get some time, some mm-hmm. me time. She's like, look, just go for 2 hours. This baby's going to be fine. Mm-hmm. I've raised three of you. I got this, Diamond. Mm-hmm. And she still has to remind me now. I have a 16-month-old. Mm-hmm. She's got, like, Diamond, I got this. She's going to be fine. So just really having that support, and also being able to talk about what I needed. That's something mm-hmm. important, too. So, and I felt more comfortable speaking to other moms who were honest with me, like, you know, oh, the baby didn't sleep. I feel really sad. I feel really defeated. I don't know what's going on. I'm like, oh my gosh, I feel the same way.
Right.
You know, so sometimes you don't even know that you went through it. And I look back like, oh, those first 8 weeks, that was like a blur. I was like, oh.
So let me ask this question. Because I came by your house a couple times. And were you feeling that way the first time I came by your house, or were you done with that?
I felt pretty much done with it at that point.
Oh, I was going to say, you pretended like you really had things under control. My radar was up, because I was like, let me see if Diamond's okay. Actually, that was part of my motivation for reaching out to you saying, hey, can I come by? Yeah. And I remember when I brought the cake. I think I brought the cake before the first real visit. Mm-hmm. Yes, so I had this cake, and then you commented, I want some. And so I thought immediately, let me bring this to her. And it was a 25-minute drive, but it was worth it.
I appreciate
it. Well, it was worth it.
Yeah.
Because I felt that it was the contact that you may have needed,
mm-hmm.
and I wouldn't have known unless I showed up. So I brought the cake, and then when you shut the door, I said, she's got it under control. And then when I came by to spend time with you, I said, look at Diamond running around, and she's having a meeting on the phone, and the baby's playing, and she's not impulsively responding to the baby. She's got it under control. So I just wanted to make sure that I was not reading that improperly.
Yeah. No,
okay.
No, I felt really fine. Good. Okay. You know what? I have my moments. Even still today, I'll have my moments. I would say those first 8 weeks, even which I believe mom stayed longer.
Yep.
Because she's like, Let me make sure you're good, because you're still randomly crying. You're still feeling up and down. Okay. I felt like for me, that was most of like my up and down emotions, where, and I wasn't my same self. Where people who know me, my friends, know that I'm always sending that positive energy. I'm like, yes, let's do it.
Yeah, let's hang out, and I'm
sending vibes. Like, I'm thinking about you. And there was a moment where I went silent.
Okay.
And those friends who knew me, they're like, would check in. And they wouldn't even ask, like, hey, are you depressed? Right. Are you this? But they're just like, hey, sending you love. Like, you got this, mama. Encouragement. Right. You know, my mom and my sisters and my sister-in-law, mother-in-law, everybody coming to town and spending a week or so, you know, when I didn't even know what to ask for. But I would say probably the first 2 months, maybe even 3 months, I would say was like the peak of the depression for me. And then even to this day, I can say I have my moments where I'm like, oh, I don't know what I'm doing. And I would just call my mom or call my best friends and just be like,
you think that's
last night? Yeah, I know. Last night when she wasn't sleeping, I just was like tears, because I'm like, okay, I'm tired.
Part of that's
what
exhaustion.
Do we do? Yeah, the exhaustion really, I believe that that's when the mental part comes in, because you're exhausted and you don't even know what to do. So that even brings about the depression. So I had to remind myself to practice and use my tools that I know work for me, like we talked about gratitude at the beginning. We talked about like mommy and self-care. I know I made a post and so many moms and non-moms commented like, this is what I do. And I love just to share the different ideas and things that you do, because we all have it. And depression is such, it has such a negative connotation. And I think that's why no one wants to say like, oh, I was depressed. Oh, I was this.
I'm over that.
Yeah, but it's like up and down. I have one girlfriend who told me that she probably not until her baby was one did she even start to feel depressed. So it comes, it can happen all the way up until 2 years old. Yeah. She was like, I didn't feel, and because I was explaining to her some of the things that I felt, and she was like, that didn't happen for me in the beginning, because you know I was so excited. Like, she was overjoyed to be a mom, and so, but then when the baby started getting older, that's when she started feeling more of her depression and things like that.
So there's definitely, again, I guess maybe three aspects of signs or factors within postpartum. And I'm a guy, so I can't, I don't know if I'm not feeling comfortable speaking about these things, because we're talking about something that affects women, but it also affects the men and your partners, you know, that you're in a relationship with. So I wanted to talk about the emotional impact, the physical as well as the behavioral impact that postpartum has. And some of them we've already discussed, as far as like the uncontrollable crying, just the basic features of depression, but also, you know, the changes in the appetite, the feeling hopeless, the excessive worry. So it's like a combination of depression and anxiety at the same time, which is, you know, very difficult to kind of manage even without having a child. But if you have like previous family members, or you've had your own bouts with depression or anxiety prior to the baby coming, that's more than likely you're probably going to experience postpartum depression as well. So,
well, I want to give my experience since I have also produced a human. You know, there's a large percentage of mothers who deal with that, just having a healthy child, and then there is a very large percentage of mothers who are nowhere near prepared and having no discussions about what if your child is not born the way that you envision. And so my bout with that is way rougher and way more long term, and it turned into serious and severe depression. And it's more difficult when you're around people in your immediate circle who don't believe in seeking help in certain ways, because it's looked down upon in the Black community, especially people you live with, cohabitate with, or anyone else in your immediate circle who kind of condemns you for wanting to express, I am depressed, I am having thoughts of suicide, I do not know who I am, because this is unforeseen. I know that especially in the Black community, we like to band-aid over emotions. We use prayer a lot. We do, to serve as a band-aid over newborn situations, right? Just pray for a healthy baby. Just pray, pray, pray. Okay, now let's examine what happens if there is something going on, which happens more often, I guess, than people would ever imagine. But I wish there were conversations had of mental preparation. Mm-hmm. Listen, if this doesn't turn out the way you envision, what kind of steps are you going to take, and what kind of avenues could you take in order to educate yourself on these things? Who could you talk to? Oh, there's a social worker at the hospital. Oh, there's blah, blah. Like, you should start thinking about those mm-hmm. things, honestly, when you go in, and that would help to suffice and kind of reduce the unexpectancy that comes along with having those situations. You are immediately forced to talk to people you don't want to talk to. Some people don't want to talk to anyone after they've had a baby. So I think it's much harder when you don't understand what's going on. I know that mine lasted for probably the first 2 or 3 years. Mm-hmm. The constant up and down, the anxiety of not knowing what comes along with the condition adds to that. And so the child can absorb it. And then the mother feels guilty for that. Then everyone in the house can absorb it, right? Mm-hmm. Because if you're emotionally taxed, you're taxing everyone around you. So that was my experience that I have more than no problem mentioning, because a lot of women are just, they just are not comfortable talking about the differences. And I know for sure that that can lead to postpartum in toddlerhood for mothers, because when they notice their child's not speaking when they should be, a lot of them don't say anything. They're very scared that the child's going to be diagnosed. You know what I mean? Like, they're not meeting milestones. The parents become concerned that the child is going to be diagnosed with something they're not ready for. So that is part of that as well.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Damien?
And even too, but I think speaking from the male perspective, Tim was very supportive. And even how I mentioned before, like, we found that his friends, or at least in his circle, they were a little bit more honest. So he actually was prepared in advance for some of the things that I was going to go through.
Right.
So things like, one day I remember waking up and I was like, I want to leave. Like, you and Emerald. Mm-hmm. Like, I'm leaving now. And he's just like, okay, well, where do you want to go? And I was like, I don't know, but just away.
He's going to make sure you go into a safe place.
Right. He's like, okay, well, let's just sleep the rest of the night. And then we can decide on, you know, what we're going to do. Okay. You know, just very patient in what he didn't take anything personally or what I said. Even at times where I was like, did we even make the right decision to have a baby? Like, what are we doing? You know, so I feel like all of those things are symptoms, a part of just kind of like that emotional part. So if you want to call it baby blues, if you want to call it depression, whatever you want to call it, it definitely, you know, it affects what's going on in your relationship, things like that. And the men too have the same things. They have the depression and different symptoms and different things like that, not in the same way as the woman from a hormonal.
It may come off as the you get like the irritability part. Mm-hmm. And the part of the helplessness, because, you know, you're going through this individual thing, but we're getting the residuals of that, whether that's the, I want to leave, you know, we're kind of on pins and needles, you know, coming from a guy that's experienced two, you know, separate births, you know, and each pregnancy is different, you know. For some, you may not experience it at all, the first couple babies that you have, and then this last one you have, you're like, oh my gosh, like, where did that come from? But just getting the residuals and that transference of energy affects us negatively. Not as much as you guys, but it definitely affects us in having those same thoughts like, oh, like, well, I got to deal with this. Like, yeah, I'm walking on pins and needles and, you know, not making enough noise because I don't want to wake up the baby. Now, I want her to get some rest, but she's going off on me, so I want to leave and I don't want to be here. And, you know, all these different types of things. But, We definitely get a piece of that as well.
I think that gets into ways to help avoid it. And I want to say that I think, you know, spouses can be more supportive of just observing and being loud about it. You know, hey, babe, I noticed you a little irritable lately. I think you should take a day. Go to South Carolina. Visit your auntie. Here's some money. I filled the gas tank with gas. I packed your bag. Whatever. I'm sure she'd be happy. But I think if we're getting up, and I'm sorry, but a lot of times it's the case that the woman is the one primarily or solely getting up in the middle of the night, suffering from exhaustion, and then being expected to cook every meal and take care of the house. It is a lot. And so I think the spouses can help.
That's something that, one, if your communication is effective in your relationship and you guys are solid, that's a conversation you have during pregnancy. Like, okay, like, for example, I may say, okay, well, because I'm getting up at the crack of dawn and I'm working 12 hours, you know, it might be pretty difficult for me to get up in the middle of the night to change the diapers and things like that. But on the weekend, I got you. I'm cooking everything. I'm making sure the baby is good because I'm there, you know, 24/7. But I think it's a compromise, and it has to be, you know, a conversation that needs to be had prior to the baby getting here, because, you know, whether you're a first time parent or, you know, it's your 10th child, you still have to have those conversations and what it looks like, you know, once the baby is here.
Because a lot of times you don't know what you need until the baby
right.
is here. So,
well, right. So that's my thing. Karan was my first child. I didn't know what I needed. I was so focused at 3 months on what kind of health the baby will be in. I didn't think to have those conversations. And even if they had, somebody might say one thing at the time.
Right.
And then when they're thinking about their corporate job the next morning and she's got it under control, I don't think it's purposefully done, but I just think sometimes people get wrapped up in their own idea of mm-hmm. what's going to work for them the next day. Mm-hmm. I'm sorry, but not every husband is as sensitive as Tim is and yeah. is able to say, all right, look, okay, sure. No, that's not usually
because usually
the
what happens is when we're met with aggression and the irritability, and we come back with that aggression yeah. and the irritability, which causes even more dysfunction, even more depression and anxiety. And now it's not necessarily about you and the baby, it's about you and your partner. Whether y'all gonna make it through this particular, you know,
yes.
time period, because you're gonna have to deal with that probably until, you know, the baby is mm-hmm. kind of self-sufficient in terms of, you know, the sleep cycle and things like that, when that becomes a normal thing, you know, and they're able to walk, you know, by themselves, or, you know, put the bottle to their mouth, you know, by themselves, things like that. You're going to have to deal with that.
Go ahead.
And just knowing that some things just come with the territory. So mm-hmm. you can't expect your newborn toddler to sleep through the night every night of
right.
the week, because mm-hmm. they're going through growth spurts. They're having teeth and they may get mm-hmm. sick. Different things. Just like you as a full-on adult human, you
right.
don't sleep through the night all the time. You wake up, you're
right.
thirsty, you
right.
have to go to the restroom, whatever mm-hmm. the case. So we have to understand that these are little humans, and you know, they have feelings and different moods and different things like that. So just being intentional about that.
Right.
But even to your point, like, the woman sets the tone of the household.
Right.
So, you know, if you're coming with an attitude and things like that, it does kind of, it is reflective.
That's a whole
so
nother
I was
going
to say, that's another show to talk
yeah.
about.
I almost
yeah. working
used the
in
word
your
that
feminine
I didn't want to use this word
while
Diamond's sitting here all
energy.
Nice and pretty in her skirt. I didn't want to use this word. It was volatile, the B word I was going to say.
If you acted like it, that's how you acted.
You're going to get greeted.
That's
well,
that's
true.
Receive.
You're going to yep. receive that. But I want to make a comment that even though we're talking about, you know, postpartum, part of the definition is having to do with recently having a baby, the strong emotions and changes, anxiety and sadness, can hit at any point yep. when you have a child, period, point blank. My son is 10, and it happens to me randomly several weeks at a time, once in a while, very brief, but where I feel like, what am I doing? Like, what am I doing? Am I making the right choices? Are these the right decisions? Is he going to be affected? That
right.
happens all the time.
I mean, it truly depends on, you know, what's going on in your life at that particular time. What are you worried about with your child? If it's physical health, is it making sure they're getting adequate, you know, the right education? You know, are y'all, you know, stable? You know, all those different types of questions. So you got to look at the different factors that lead to those particular thoughts and those emotions that you do have. But, you know, it varies from person to person, like we've been saying. Now, one thing I did want to kind of get into, because there's definitely some mild cases of postpartum depression, but then we also have these severe cases that we normally would see on the news, social media, things like that. For example, a lady just recently went to trial for attempting to drown her twins
mm-hmm.
in the bathtub or something
mm-hmm,
like
mm-hmm.
that. And those are like regular, I'm not going to say regular.
Well, they're more regular now, occurrences.
Yeah, it's regular occurrences. I really have a distinct memory, like back in the day, you know, in Orangeburg, it was a girl that I went to school with, high school with, you know, cool, athletic, all these things. She had a baby, and maybe about 2 months after she gave birth to the baby, they found the baby, like, under the house.
Mm-hmm.
She killed the baby and left him up under the house.
Mm.
So, of course, she went to jail. But those were episodes of whether it's postpartum psychosis or postpartum depression or whatever you want to call it. You know, it definitely was happening, and people were calling her, you know, crazy and all these different types of things. Mm-hmm. Whereas prior to her becoming pregnant, you know, she was relatively normal.
You know, I remember there is a woman recently, I would say recently meaning the past 3 years, and she was the minivan in the ocean.
Mm-hmm.
She drove, you know what I'm talking
about? Yeah.
They were on the sand, and there was a bystander who had noticed, and then a couple more guys came over. So it was actually two guys that wound up at the car. And I watched the interviews, and then I watched hers later, you know, while the prison stuff and all that. And, you know, her and her sound mind saying, this is where my head was from what I remember, and this is what I feel now. And I realized I was having judgments about the news reporter talking her up in this way of, oh, she feels better and she's medicated now, so she's doing this. And the news people were very happy. And I was thinking, what's wrong with me? What's wrong with me as a therapist that I can't adjust to this new form of this person, right? Where she's medicated. I mean, I was battling my own mental turmoil with that and how I felt about it.
Right.
But the guys were saying that they came up to the car close enough to say, are you okay? And if y'all had seen it, the woman responded, we're okay. And she had said it very calmly, and then they kind of turned to each other like, oh, she's not okay. They're going in there, and we have to save them. So they kind of clung to the car. There was a video. If you look it up on YouTube, woman drives into ocean, you'll see the video. But somebody actually got it on video, and one is hanging on the car trying to get through the window to snatch the kids. It's the saddest thing I've ever seen. But I don't know. I also have issues sometimes with people blaming everything on postpartum. I think depression and not being able to establish what reality is, I haven't figured out how I really feel about,
I think it's more so because you're talking about mental health, and it's a juicy topic nowadays. We often get that judgment like, oh, it's not really a mental health issue. This person is really, you know, this was well thought out. You know, this was premeditated, all those things. But, you know, they could have had mental health issues prior
to. She had bipolar.
You know,
she
prior did. To. Yeah. So so that exacerbates a lot of the symptoms, you know, especially when you're talking about hormones and chemical imbalances and things like that. So, but just talking about the postpartum psychosis, I mean, that's just like you were saying, like the lady was just looking like she was there, but she wasn't. Like she was
very
mentally
calm.
Gone. You know, she was just stuck in her thoughts. So I mean, that's severe cases, which is normally, it's a really low number. It's like 1 to 2 mothers per 1,000, something like that. So it's really low in the percentage, but that's still a lot about people being born every day.
Along with that, I realized what the thing was that bothered me, that she's spending time with the kids now. And the argument is, she's medicated, she's better, and now she's going to be spending... Yeah, I had an issue with it. I did.
Oh,
I still do.
Oh, that attempted to drown.
Yes, when the kids were in the back talking about, mommy's trying to kill us. And I'm thinking, oh my God, the poor babies have trauma, they have PTSD. You're exposing them, re-exposing them. They're going to be reliving it every time they're visiting with her. I don't know what's right or wrong about that situation.
I mean...
You know what I mean? It's their mother on one end.
You know, everyone loves their mother, and the love hormone...
tell us.
Oxytocin.
Makes
you love your mother unconditionally. So
regardless,
no matter how good or bad your mother may be.
Now we know Donna is one of those Facebook therapists that we talk about, but I will never talk about her in a negative light. I like this information. It sounds good, actually.
I will tell you, I am not a doctor. I will
not turn my nature
or anything.
I appreciate that.
I will Google something.
But, I mean, we talked about, you know, definitely how it affects the children. I mean, the mothers attempting to harm the children, but we don't talk about them actually turning that hurt onto themselves.
Mm-hmm.
And there's been a growing epidemic as far as, you know, the mothers committing or dying by suicide or attempting to kill themselves and their spouse and the kids, you know, everybody gone, you know, because they're dealing with these problems and they haven't been able to openly express their emotions. Or they have expressed it, and they're in an invalidating environment to where they don't feel support. So, you know, when you don't feel supported, you know, you're going to scream to the highest heights, you know, to whatever, to get your point across. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I find it really difficult to really talk about this, and I'm not even a woman, so.
Yeah, you're doing a good job.
It's a difficult topic. You are doing a great job. I think the biggest thing that we need to know that we are not alone.
Mm-hmm.
Moms,
mm-hmm.
dads,
right.
We're not alone in this. And
mm-hmm.
I think that's where a lot of the depression or the
right.
feelings may come from, because
right.
you think, like, everyone else is so happy. Like, why am I not? And so we're living in this digital world, and we're on social media, and we can just scroll,
mm-hmm.
and
right.
we see everyone's highlight reel. We need to understand that. How many takes did it take them to get that? Or what are they
mm-hmm.
actually going through?
Or what are they
right.
doing with
now? It's really
right.
happening. So we don't want to we want to try our best not to compare. And
mm-hmm.
just know, again, you're not alone. You're
right.
not alone. You're not alone. I
you
can't express
are
that
not
enough.
Not
yeah.
alone.
Oh, Lord.
That would have been a great
so, time. Yeah, no, right? I should have put that on the soundtrack.
Just keep talking.
So we, I definitely want to kind of, before we wrap it up here, I definitely want to talk about ways, and we've already discussed some of them, but ways that we can support, you know, our mothers during this particular time, things that we should do, things that we should not do. Because some people may not know, like, how do I support this person that's, you know, being an asshole or a bitch towards me? How do I support this person? You know, do I tell them to snap out of it? Do I just kind of let them do their thing?
I appreciate your candor.
Yeah, I mean,
knock
it is
me
what it
off
is.
For a minute.
But
yes.
But so let's talk about
how do I help this bitch?
Yeah. So how do we help support the mom? You know, to make sure she's getting what she needs in order to, you know, survive and make sure that we survive.
Diamond, you want to give something and I'll give something?
Yeah, I'll just say check on your friend, even if it's not your friend. If
mm-hmm.
you see a new mom, send her a social media message. Hey, checking in on you.
Right.
Sending you love and light. Gaining your tribe, building your tribe. And yeah, just finding those local resources. And if you have a good support system like family,
mm-hmm.
do that. But if you don't have that blood family, quote unquote,
mm-hmm.
reach out.
Yeah.
Any mom will be able to and be happy to talk to you.
Right.
Reach out to me. Diamond.nurse on social media.
Reach out and touch.
Right, you got
somebody.
I'm happy to share and just to support, because like you said, we need that support.
Yeah.
And we need to get back to the village.
Yeah,
the village
absolutely.
Has been lost over the years. And
yes.
so creating that
support,
village.
Support. Definitely.
Well,
definitely.
My idea is, I believe men pick up on a woman's attitude very quickly, whether it's positive or negative. And when you notice going in a negative direction and the woman has just had a baby in the last year, I believe it's your place to offer to bring home dinner. If that's 3 days a week that week, then just
mm-hmm.
bring home the damn dinner. Okay,
right.
She can order Uber Eats. You can offer to pay for it.
Mm-hmm.
She's focused on running the house the way that she thinks you would like it to be run, number
right.
one. She wants to please you and take care of the baby.
Right.
And I think even though that sounds easy to go to your phone and order Uber Eats, most wives, especially of newborns, they really want to please their husbands. They want to show their husbands that they're still about them and not forgetting about them.
Mm-hmm.
And they don't necessarily want to order out multiple days in the week. I think it's okay for the husbands to offer time away. I like that you said your husband
mm-hmm.
basically is like, okay, I see that you need this, so you need to do that.
Right.
A lot of women feel very uncomfortable asking for that, especially when they feel like roles have been discussed before the baby has been had. Now they're dealing with this swing of emotions and,
right.
and don't know what to do.
Right.
So I think it's the man's place to step up and offer when he notices.
I'm not going to specifically talk about what the guy should do, but I'm going to speak about village in general. But one thing that I did notice when I did experience, you know, childbirth, well, not me, you know, particularly, but you know what I mean?
When
my kids were born.
Okay.
A lot of the support came in as people asking about the baby, or let
right.
me hold the baby, or,
you,
you know, let me take the baby off your hand, but not asking about how she's doing.
Mm-hmm.
The person, the mother, asking legitimately how she's feeling emotionally, physically, all those things. They're more so concerned about the baby. So that's definitely one thing I said that you should not do, is focus your time, your energy on the baby. You know, kind of split your time there.
You know what? Thank you for saying that, because on the reverse, stop lying to us when we ask you about how you're doing after the baby. Okay?
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay? I'm just saying, I get really aggravated. You want support and you want to be falling into that? Or do you want to be honest with someone who's trying to help you? Mm-hmm. And even though I felt in my mind that you had things under control, when your birthday came and we were just barely friends, I brought you stuff that I felt you could use. Because I said, now, I don't know her well enough to know if she's lying. So, you know what? But it would have felt good to me. So I want to give that energy to other people. Right. If I think about you, you know, I thought about Diamond. She over there with that baby running rampant, tossing stuff all over the place. I know it drives me freaking nuts. And I have a 10-year-old. Just the idea of somebody with a newborn, it really drives me insane. So I really try to put myself in that position. What could I have used? Maybe somebody to offer to bring by and you know what I'm saying? Show up for me.
That's one thing that I noted as well. Quit asking. You know, quit asking. Yeah, and just do it. Like, if you feel like she needs a break, come over there and take the baby and, you know, tell her to go take a nap, tell her to go shopping, tell her to do whatever.
I cannot agree more.
Yeah, like, don't ask. Because people, that's what we generally do. Well, if you need anything, just call.
Wait a minute. Nah. Are you not a stubborn mom, Diamond? No. If somebody offered you time, like, would you like me to come and watch the baby for an hour? Would you leave?
If you ask me like that, no. I like you? If you say, oh, girl, I'm coming over. You take a shower now. I probably wouldn't leave because I'm like, wait, what's going on? Right. But I would go upstairs and take a shower with my cameras throughout my whole house. But
so if I say, look, next week on Wednesday afternoon, if you're home Emerald, I'll watch her for an hour or two and you go make runs.
Absolutely. And friends have done that. Friends have
I'll be there next week on meals. Wednesday.
Okay.
You have to give me the time.
Tim, baby, you watching? Write it down.
Look, Wednesday. Yeah, what time? It has to be after the show.
Right.
If you want a night, okay, now she's going too far. Now I said afternoon. So she wants the night. So this is what black people do. This is why you don't offer them anything.
You didn't.
Okay, that's fine. So we're saying it right now because I'm going to play the playback next week. So you're saying that after the show, you want to go out with your husband.
Yep.
I'm giving you 2 hours. You'll find me in the baby pastel.
Okay. That's all I need.
Okay, fine. There it is.
You see what I'm saying? So, yeah, just don't ask.
There you go.
Just do it. And they would have to, you would have to be the one to be like, nah, like, that's too much. I'm feeling anxiety. I can't be away from my baby.
If you cancel it, I'll talk about it on the show in 2 weeks. Just get ready to watch that show. That's fine. I'll be talking about it.
Another one is to definitely celebrate small steps, you know, milestones. If the baby finally latched on and mom was struggling with the baby latching, or the baby slept throughout the night for the first time. You know, you want to celebrate those things along with the mother so she doesn't feel like she's alone. And I think that's one of the biggest things, that moms just feel alone.
That sounds so nice,
Damien.
You know what I mean? That's what I'm saying. You sound so in tune with us.
You know what I'm saying?
I appreciate that. But that smooth groove music in the beginning.
It works out.
Had some kind of, okay.
It works out. Clearly know what you're doing. Growing up with sisters.
Yeah.
You know, it helps. But also, last thing is being conscious of your own emotions and your feelings. So guys, you know, be conscious, aware of how you're feeling towards your significant other or your baby mom, whatever you want to call her, wife. You know, make sure that you're aware of how you're feeling. Make sure that you're not transferring.
Turn the classiness down. I was really involved. I was emotionally attached to your statement before you.
That's
a stigma. It was a stigma. I mean, I wasn't married when I had mine. I have no judgment. But I just, when you
baby mama.
Yeah, like, just when you said it. I mean, you can't just call her a bitch every time you're in conversation with her. Because
if she's being a bitch,
You can't do that because it's going to cause her to be more bitchy.
Right.
It is what it is. So just be conscious of your responses to the moms, you know, when they're having their own episodes.
Okay.
You know, things that we shouldn't do. Things that other people shouldn't do.
Don't call her a bitch.
Right.
Yeah, I'm sorry, but that's not the greatest approach to relief from depression.
I want to go back to what you're saying, things that you should do.
Okay.
Something that I just wanted to highlight that a group of my girlfriends and I did here in Charlotte, and it was probably like 10 of us who had babies all at the same time.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
Literally.
We got our tribe.
Yeah. We literally, for the moms, we all got together, and each person who was having a baby, we gave them like mom things, from like a nursing bra, tank tops, pajamas, you know, nipple cream, everything. everything that you could think of, like, you know, that the mom might need. Yeah.
Not the one.
Not the edible kind.
Okay.
Well the baby. Not the.
It's for the baby. Yeah. Don't you worry about it. It's for the baby. You know what I mean. That's another episode.
Yes, it is. That's one of those episodes that Jackie would get so, she would get so flustered.
I want to, off the nipple cream.
But just a little care package for the moms. And that was something really cool. So now when I even attend baby showers, I think about the moms. Because to your point, we just think about the babies and the beautiful little outfits and blankets and toys and this. Mm-hmm. But it's like, the mom is going to need those nice pajamas and make comfortable wear when people come and visit.
Yeah, get her some nice workout. Yeah, get her some lingerie so she can start to feel sexy again.
Right.
Yeah, get all that.
I prefer the monetary gifts. So my girlfriend from Chicago, we went to high school together, and after I had Karan, I was struggling with the emotional up and down of like having the special needs medical situation. Mm-hmm. And you know, some people know, a lot of people on Facebook know, we had made this big post because we had to go live in Boston, and I was living there with this baby in a extended stay hotel, and I was miserable, just scared all the time, something's gonna happen. And his father was still working in Charlotte while he put us there, and I had girlfriends steadily sending me checks. They would send me checks, and I said, look at these, come on, guys. That was the support I needed, because it came with a card that said, go get your hair done, go get your, it wasn't nipple cream, but it was money. And I appreciate you girls for sending me the money, because they sent checks every couple weeks saying, go get your nails done. Told me specifically what to do, what they wanted me to do with it. Can you go get your nails done? Can you go highlight your hair? Do whatever you need to do to fix yourself the way you want to look. Because I was so concerned. You know, moms, doesn't matter what situation you're in. Yeah. You're so concerned with what you need to do for the baby. You're not thinking about spending money on yourself.
That's why I probably wouldn't give you money, because you're going to probably end up spending on the baby.
Well, I spent it on myself.
Because you're Jackie.
Karan had enough.
Damn it, Jackie.
He had enough, damn it. We was only in a little room. He couldn't do nothing in there but sit on the bed. So I got highlights. Yes, I did.
Highlight.
Thank you.
$30. So one of those do not things is not to generalize. Now, I heard that a lot. You know, because it's so regular or it's normalized for a woman to have postpartum depression. People are like, well, you know, everyone gets it. Like, you'll get through it. Everybody's individual journey is different. Mm-hmm. So yours may be a little bit milder than, you know, your friend. So make sure that you guys do not generalize, like, well, this is what I did and this will work for me. So I'm going to tell you, you know, you'll be all right, and kind of keep it moving like that. Like, that's really invalidating. And that would probably piss me off if somebody did that to me.
I think that leads to my last comment of, you know, I had wrote down to stop measuring yourself against other mothers.
Don't compare.
I don't really care what y'all are doing. This is what works for me. And so I'm glad people are doing what works for them.
Right.
But I'm not looking at somebody and saying, oh, Diamond gets time away, or she's in this situation where her husband can help her. No, I'm grateful for the half the week that Karan's with his father. Mm-hmm. So I can have my time alone. I like having my time alone. So that's what it looks like for me. I need at least 2 days a week alone to myself and two nights.
So you might want to consider the LAT lifestyle with your partner.
Well, I don't know if I'll increase my progressive thinking relationship-wise. I'm a little too territorial with that. But I can admit that.
I have to think about somebody else at the crib.
It doesn't have to be. I like somebody around. Some people just like to have the person that they're with around, and that's why a lot of people get married.
I
don't need him to have that much space.
So when we do get together, I'm gonna have my space, but you need to sit your ass right here
and be there when I get back.
I want to miss you sometimes.
Go to another room.
Go to work.
Get your coins.
That emotional connection is cool. I feel the emotional connection, but that physical connection, I need to, I'm gonna stay over here in my crib tonight.
Okay.
No, I want to miss you. So.
But remember, you're cool with that alternative.
When I see you tomorrow night, it's on and popping. You know what I'm saying? So that's why. I see you all the time.
Okay.
I'm sure a lot of people will tune into that episode. So y'all gotta put that in.
Alternative marital lifestyle.
Anytime we talk about sex, it's on popping. Oh, Jackie is the one.
Oh, guys, I'm uncomfortable. Well, it's 6:33. So
we're gonna go ahead and close it out. It was definitely a great conversation. Mm-hmm. We appreciate Ms. Diamond. Nurse for stopping by, you know, dropping some jewels and some information on our own experiences. Where can people find you? Where can they, you know, get at you?
And what you got going on.
Yeah, what you got
Tell
going
it all.
On.
Look, so you can find me on social media, Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, diamond.nurse. And then you can also follow us at Nurse Monthly Mingle. If you're in Charlotte or just visiting Charlotte, we do events where we get like-minded people together. We do everything from going on hikes together to Sunday fun day brunches to galas. Our next event is coming August 11th. It's going to be at Imperial. We have a Sunday fun day brunch called the Reset Sundays. Follow us at Nurse Monthly Mingle for all the details.
Wait, don't people meet at your events and then get married and things?
They do. We actually have a few people who have met, gotten married. Look, we have some girlfriends who just met and just friendships.
Single.
And ready to mingle.
And ready to mingle.
Yeah, y'all go out there. Y'all see what I'm working with. So y'all might want to, you know, show up and show off. Those definitely.
Single.
Support. Jackie, any closing?
No, I think I've said enough. I have today.
Right.
So yeah. I believe in everything I said.
Okay.
That's it. Diamond, I'm glad that you
Thank
were here.
You.
Thank you for being here. I
Happy
love you.
Love
Chicago
you.
Women do it better, so Shut that's why she's here. And Damien, we appreciate you engaging very actively in this conversation. All these conversations are not comfortable for men to participate in. So I just want to acknowledge that
I appreciate you
being as active at times with us.
I'm the Ralph Tresvant.
There's some moments I wish I could have taken a photo of your face where you were like, what? Mm-hmm.
No.
So, but you were very active in this conversation, so we appreciate it.
I appreciate you guys opening up and, you know, telling your stories. And I hope that will promote other women to, you know, be forthcoming with how they're feeling, you know, dealing with pregnancy and after, you know, prior to and after. So definitely good conversation. Keep it going. Got anything coming up?
Yes.
Jackie?
Don't forget the book on lulu.com. That's lulu.com. My gift to you. Second edition by Jacqueline F. Curry. And that's F. Dot. Then we have August 17th, the book signing. And you have Barbershop Talk Thursday.
Tomorrow, you guys, Barbershop Talk at West Charlotte. Some good clinicians going to be out there. We're going to have, you know, some barbers. You know, it's going to be a sit down, chill, talk, man talk. But women are actually.
Really?
Can come and get some insight on what our thoughts are and
or
what our feelings
are. Or you can come and meet a man.
So definitely, that's where we're going to be at. We're going to be at the barbershop
that's
talk
why
tomorrow.
They're
so
really
if you
going.
Do, you know, come holler. You know, it might have some available, you know, bachelors out there. You just never know. So definitely, it starts at 5:30, 5:30, 8:30 tomorrow at West Shaw. We're going to have a good time, some free food, you know. Free food is always
Diamond says, shoot you shot.
I think my guy Fly Ty is hosting
okay.
it.
Okay. Oh, okay.
So it's going to be pretty dope.
Okay,
sure.
Great. I'm glad.
And also the August 17th as well, the back to school
drive
that we have.
Oh, yeah, the back to school drive and the book signing on the same day.
Yes, absolutely. Okay. So we're definitely on the move.
Yeah.
You know, if you want to reach out to either one of us, you know, for engagements, you know, contact our secretary.
Oh, yeah, especially churches.
Our people.
Churches
our
in
people.
Charlotte, okay? We lit up the Black Caucus last
yes.
week, all right? We want to come to your church and talk about mental health and the importance of having a therapist and a pastor.
Yes.
And not intertwining.
Hey.
The two.
And we like the, you know, the donations.
Oh, the donation.
For the services, you guys.
The
you know.
Donations?
Yeah.
Are they donations or are we don't want to call it a donation.
No, it's not a
we'll
donation.
Cut this
but I'm just trying to be politically correct right now. And at the end of our show, we usually
yes.
get kind of ratchet.
Oh, yeah,
so
we do. For the last few minutes,
it is
yeah.
What it
okay.
Is.
All right. So
well, everybody know
we're
I'm
coming
kidding,
to your
I'm,
church.
I'm kidding, but I'm serious.
Yeah, I'm not kidding.
Yeah.
I want to
yeah.
come to more churches.
It takes too much time.
This yeah. mental health information.
Yeah.
They weren't ready.
Intellectual property.
All right, we're here.
All
See
right,
you
guys.
All next week.
Next week,
Rashawn
we're
Miller.
Have, yes, we're going to have our guy, Rashawn Miller, one of the huge mental health advocates out there in the community doing his thing. He'll be back next week to drop some more jewels and some gems for you guys. I don't know a specific topic.
I don't either. We haven't planned that yet. But Rashawn, if you're watching, come with a topic.
That's all I got. We're going to have a good time.
Yeah,
anyway.
Yeah. It doesn't matter. We'll find something in
yeah.
mental health, okay?
Yeah, we're going to talk about it. Like
okay.
we always do, Can We Talk, Your Mental Health Matters, thecouch704.com. Get all that. IG, Facebook, get it all. All right.
Thanks for tuning in.
Peace out.
See you guys next week. Bye-bye.
Yeah. I'm still on, so don't say nothing.
I know. I was about to sing, and I couldn't think of what song to sing.
The mic is alive.
Your mental health matters.